You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome to Health Science 300, Health in Public Education. I'm Robin Sinks, I'm your instructor for this course, and we are in our fifth broadcast of the semester. And today we're going to start talking about the second content area, mental, emotional, and social health. If you'll recall, last week we talked about the first content area, personal and community health. So I hope this week you thought a little bit more about your own personal health habits, whether that was brushing your teeth or washing your hands or being a little bit more sun safe. And I hope you had an opportunity to take what you learned last week and apply that within the classrooms in which you are currently working. Or with the children that you are currently interacting with. Certainly, as we go through each of these content areas, while we talk about them separately, I do want to remind you that they are all interconnected. As we talk about mental health today, certainly think about the impact that sleep has on our mental health. Or that taking care of ourselves may be a result of our mental health. And when our mental health is not at its best, we may not take as good care of those physical, personal hygiene practices. So I do want you to just remember to keep in mind that they are all connected. Certainly, I want to remind each of you that you have the opportunity to participate in this morning's broadcast. You can call in your questions, there's the phone number, or you can email those questions to me. And you can certainly call or email your response to my question of the day. Remember that you do get some extra credit for participating in the live broadcast. So there's our question of the day. After reading chapter 5, which you should have read before we started this morning, I want you to think about how you support the mental, emotional health of children. So what is it that you do? Whether you're working in a classroom or you're working with children in a more informal basis, or if you're not working with children right now, what do you think you will do to support their mental, emotional health? Certainly, Chapter 5 gave you a lot of ideas. I'm guessing some of you said, oh yeah, I do that. Oh, I've never thought about that. Maybe I could pull that into my interactions with kids. So certainly I want you to think about that as we go along. Here at the top of the hour, before we actually get started on content, while you're all thinking about that, I do want to remind you about an announcement I did post on Blackboard this week. The October 8 CPR class has been postponed until November 5th. So if you signed up for that October 8th class and now want to come to November 5, please email me again. I just want to make sure that the change of date will still accommodate your schedule. It was an unforeseen and an unavoidable incident that took place that required us to move that training. But November 5th, you can still get your CPR certification in time to meet the course co-requisite. So don't forget that. I also want to remind you that your next discussion board is due October 17. Now that seems a long way away, but as you know, time will pass very quickly. So I want to encourage each of you to go to the discussion board, review the instructions, go back to the syllabus, review the scoring guide, and start to think about which three websites you will review for that assignment. You'll pick one website for personal and community health, what we did last week. You'll pick one website for mental, emotional, social health, what we're doing this week. And one website for nutrition and physical activity, which we'll actually spend the next 2 weeks addressing. So I want you to start thinking about that and start planning it. October 17 is also the day of our next exam, so you don't want to be doing everything on Sunday night and Monday, so start to plan ahead and do that. I do just want to take a quick minute to show you a couple of websites I didn't get to last week that you can kind of start to think about for reviews. You can also look at the end of each of the chapters that we're addressing, and there's a list of internet sites that you can also take a look. You can also just find one on your own, so please feel free to do so. So if we could go to my desktop for just a minute, I do just want to highlight a few websites for your consideration. The first is the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and that website is cdc.gov. This literally has everything health related on it. If you go to the CDC A to Z, you will find a whole listing and you can click by topic or you can put in the search. Up on the very first page, lots of different current topics, Zika being one. Animals in school, the impact of germs that animals may carry. Adults need vaccines. So certainly a lot of good information there. One website for your consideration. The next is what's called kidshealth.org. I love this website. It's by the Nemours Foundation. Provides medically accurate current information geared towards parents, kids, teens, and educators. And there are accompanying websites in Spanish for families who may need that language support. I encourage you to look at each of the parts of this website, in particular noting the educator site, which also includes lesson plans around some of the health topics that we talked about. And this is a website, again, both these two are addressing content from last week. It will have content from this week. It will have content from every week here on out. So these are very broad kinds of resources. Harvard Health Publications. This is health.harvard.edu. It's their newsletter and has great information, again, being from Harvard Medical School, current, accurate information for all ages and pretty much all health issues. I like this because it literally does have a specific content drop down, mind and mood, so we touch on the mental health issues. If you want to follow up with anything we talked about last week on dental health, here is mouthhealthy.org, and that is the American Dental Association's website. By age group, lots of good stories back in class, baby's first dental visit, one on flossing that's been in the news lately, so another resource. For further information about sleep, visit the nationalsleepfoundation.org. Lots of good information about the importance of sleep. Last week when we talked about skin cancer, I talked to you about the curriculum entitled Sunwise. And this is the EPA's website. Lots of information about sun safety and the UV index. American Lung Association is a national nonprofit, and you can find lots of information about lung diseases and specifically related to last week, the conversation about asthma. And then my last website, just a quick review, is the American Diabetes Association. Again, another national nonprofit, but pretty much everything you need to know about diabetes. And so I hope you will check a few of those out and possibly review one of them. And if not one of them, one identified in the textbook or of your own finding. Okay, so you should all be very familiar with the setup on Blackboard now. On this week's module or weekly readings and assignments, we are now in week 5. So mental, emotional, social health. This week you only have a journal entry due. So it would be a good week to start some of your website review. And don't forget that I did put up a sample review so you can see what one looks like, as well as the CRAAP test, which you'll use in reviewing those websites. Okay, so 10 minutes of review and kind of helping you plan for the upcoming weeks. All right, let's get back to mental, emotional, social health. Again, I hope you are all kind of thinking about what you've read this week and your response to the question of the day. How do you support the mental and emotional health of children, whether that's in a classroom, in a social setting, wherever you are, or what you think you might be doing when you get that classroom? So I want to encourage you to send in your responses by email or give me a call. While you are doing all of that, let's just go through some definitions so we're all talking about the same thing when we address the topic of mental health. Certainly, our mental health is of great importance. When we talked about the dimensions or the domains of health, we identified mental and emotional as separate domains, what we think and what we feel. It is connected to all that we do. It is linked to risky behaviors. It is linked to our physical health. And it really is an important concept to consider in that inner peace and that balance of the dimensions of health are as important as taking care of our physical body. So obviously mental health is of significant importance. So let's define it. When I say the terms mental health, what is it that you think of? Just kind of think to yourself a minute. Now compare what you are thinking to the following comments. Mental health is defined as the ability to perceive reality as it is, to respond to its challenges, and to develop rational strategies for living. Okay, how closely was yours to that? Perceiving reality as it is, responding to challenges, developing rational strategies. Mental health is characterized by the achievement of expected developmental, cognitive, social, and emotional milestones. It's also characterized by secure attachments, satisfying social relationships, and effective coping skills. Mentally healthy children and adolescents enjoy a positive quality of life and they function well at home, at school, and in their communities. That last statement is taken from the Surgeon General's report on mental health from 1999 and certainly still holds true today. So, as mental health is important in our daily lives, we also understand that there are many individuals with mental health problems. So let's consider the prevalence of those mental health problems. Just how widespread are they? When you are considering children and adolescents, 1 in 5 may have a diagnosable mental health problem. 1 in 5 may have a diagnosable mental health problem. 1 in 10 may suffer from a serious mental or emotional disorder that causes significant functional impairment. Okay, so think about the number of students you work with and play with those numbers in your head. 1 in 5 may have a diagnosable mental health problem. 1 in 10 may suffer a serious disorder that causes functional impairment. That's a bunch of our kids, right? Certainly the National Institute of Mental Health has identified some of the mental disorders that affect children and adolescents. You can certainly find a very brief synopsis of some of those on page 120 in your textbook. I encourage you to read up on each of these. You've probably addressed them in some of your other coursework, in some of your professional development, if you are currently working in a school site, but always good to kind of just touch base on them again. Take a quick review of anxiety disorders, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, the autism spectrum disorders, bipolar disorder, borderline personality disorder, depression, eating disorders, and childhood onset schizophrenia. You'll get a little bit of a review in the text. The National Association of School Psychologists have identified problems that children may face in school that affect their learning and behavior. And I'm guessing some of these you're going to be very familiar with. Stress and anxiety, worried about being bullied, problems with family or friends, coping with disabilities, depression, thoughts of suicide, concerns about their own sexuality, academic difficulties, alcohol and substance use, and the fear of violence, terrorism, and war. Okay, so those are just a few of the things that may be on our kids' minds that affect their health and their learning. Certainly, if they become a focus, they can lead to school failure, school dropout, they can exacerbate family problems, substance use, and violence. Adolescents miss more school as a result of emotional and behavioral symptoms than any other condition. Let that one sink in a minute. Adolescents miss more school as a result of emotional and behavioral symptoms than any other condition. And certainly, while treatment is expensive and it can be limited, we need to remember that mental health disorders are treatable. Early detection and treatment are really keys to minimizing the consequences of these disorders. Okay, so I want you just to kind of think about that, reflect on that. As you are working with children, know that, yes, we want to say that we're here to teach students how to read and how to solve math problems and how to use history effectively and learn science. But if they are dealing with those mental health problems, they are not focused on what you are teaching in some of the other content areas. All right, so certainly Let's take that and think about what is it that puts some of our kids at greater risk for mental health problems? What are some of those protective factors that actually help our kids, that help buffer them from some of those problems? Let's take a look at a quick video called Risk and Protective Factors for Mental Illness. Watch this. Hi, I'm Jane Berardini.
And I'm Graham Smith, and we're public health nurses working with teens in high schools in our community. This video will look at the risk factors for mental illness and also talk about how you can help protect your children from mental illness.
There are things that put people at risk for mental illness. Some of these things we can control and some of these things we can't as parents. For example, we cannot change having a family history of mental illness. However, physical illness like hormonal or chemical imbalances can be treatable. Other risk factors like academic trouble at school can be helped by working together with your child's school.
Things like family distress, such as fighting or violence, trouble with peers, unmanaged stress, or a feeling like there is no support can also put your child at risk. Poverty, violence and trauma, discrimination, and social injustice can also put your child at risk, but can be hard to control or change.
So Graham, what can we do to protect our children from mental illness?
Well, Jane, parents can help their children develop a strong sense of self and teach them coping and problem-solving skills. Try to encourage positive thinking and teach children skills that will give them confidence to handle new situations. As a parent, we want to do everything we can to enhance these protective factors that may prevent or reduce mental health challenges.
Families that get along have positive parent-child relationships. Parents should give praise for their child for doing well at school or an activity. If your child is having a hard time connecting with the family, consider linking them with a caring adult in their school or community. See our video library on parenting styles to see how you can use a balanced parenting style to help develop self-esteem, independence, and increased resilience in your child.
On a bigger level, it is important for your children to feel included and to be surrounded by a supportive community when possible. Getting your child involved in groups, sports, or community events in your area also supports their mental health. Take advantage of school, community, or faith-based programs that are low cost or free.
Enhancing protective factors and reducing risk factors will support your child's mental health and promote resilience or the ability to bounce back from difficulties and challenges. See our video library at healthunit.com for some more practical things you can do as a parent to promote mental wellness in your children. Community resources are also listed at mentalhealthforkids.ca.
Okay, so a little bit of a review from what you read in the text about risk and protective factors. The video classifies them just a little bit differently than the text. Remember, in the text, you've got individual risk and protective factors, social, or what they called interpersonal, and then environmental, which I believe they referred to as societal. Some of the, and if you look on page 123, starting on 123, you can review that discussion about risk and protective factors. And again, some of them we may not have much control over, that family history, parents with mental health disorders, prenatal exposure to substance, exposure to abuse, neglect, or traumatic events, and lack of loving relationships with at least one parent or caregiver. Certainly those may have a negative impact on a child's mental health and their well-being. There are lots of protective factors. Positive youth interactions, family support and connectedness, attachment to pro-social or positive peers and to school, a sense of purpose, a a belief in a positive future, and emotional resilience and the ability to manage feelings certainly can help our students reduce the risk for some of the mental disorders, but they may help them also address them as they come up. Because remember, some of these are recurrent illnesses, so to speak. There are those webs and flows, those highs and lows with many of them. So that's a lot of information to go back and review, and just kind of to check for a little bit of understanding. Think to yourself, is this statement true or false? Risk factors for developing a mental disorder or experiencing problems in social emotional development can include parent mental health disorders. True or false? That one's a true. When left untreated, mental health disorders can lead to school failure and drug abuse. True or false? That one's true. And so just want you to kind of keep some of that in mind. Go back and take a look at those and consider, you know, some of those things we may not be able to address. So certainly, if you can't reduce or eliminate a risk factor, we certainly want to build up those protective factors. All right, so what can we as teachers do with some of this knowledge we have and for our students? So what can teachers do? Think about what you are already doing. Think about what you learned as you read the chapter that you might be able to incorporate. Let's see, I've got a couple of comments. Let's see some of the ideas that you all have. Dominique, welcome, glad you are here this morning. Dominique says it makes myself available to students at lunch and after school if they want to talk about anything. Okay, being present, nice idea. I also try to maintain a safe, non-judgmental classroom environment for everyone. All right, thank you for sharing those. Those are a great way to support our students' mental health. And good morning, Mark. Glad you are with us. Mark says that I have many young children with ASD, Autism Spectrum Disorder, and the early years of their lives are very difficult on many levels because of their disorder and from the perspective of their developmental stages. I see in their eyes their frustration, their inability to communicate. I try not to be reactive, but responsive to their needs, whether it be a modification of expectations or classroom accommodations to make the environment more safe and comforting. Until the strategies to help them are in place, teachers have to discuss, implement, and practice compassion and patience as part of a classroom culture. I'm going to read that again. That was really good. Teachers have to discuss, implement, and practice compassion and patience as part of a classroom culture. One child's outbursts affect the entire class. So as a class family, we need to all pitch in to take care of the least of our little brothers and sisters. Wow. Thanks for sharing that, Mark. I think that's really powerful. It's not about having this laundry list of things to do, but it really is about the connections that we make with our kids. All right. Good morning, Chelsea. Thank you for being here this morning. Chelsea says, being an empathetic and positive educator creates a more functional and supported classroom for students. Having worked with children with aggression and behavioral needs, I always separate the behavior from the child. I want to read that one again. I want to separate the behavior from the child. Having compassion and understanding that the behavior is not always able to be controlled because of a diagnosis allows me to address the child with a sympathetic approachability. And mental, emotional, social health is also imperative for community and home connectedness. All right. Thank you so much for those comments. Each of you has really hit on some core traits of that classroom that is supporting a student's mental and emotional well-being. Thank you for that. Now, to those of you who haven't had a chance to send in a comment, please do so, and I'll take a break here again in a few minutes to see what you have to say. So let's go on and talk just a little bit about creating that safe and positive classroom community. The three comments already have really started to set that tone. It's a safe and positive classroom community. So what do? We can build connections daily with each and every child. We want to use consistent procedures and routines. Respond quickly to misbehavior. Find out what's going on. Notice specific positive behaviors. Just always look at the negative. Look at those positives. Use instructional design for success. How we lay out our lesson plans, how we structure our day for students can make or break that success. Try to neutralize arguments. And there are times where we might even want to delay consequences rather than reacting. Now, for some things, we need to take care of it right away. You're going to have to use your teacher expertise there. Develop an empathetic classroom culture. We already heard that one. Build connections with families. Use enforceable statements. Offer choices. And teach problem-solving skills. Those are a few ideas from the text on page 125-26. And certainly, as you read that section, think about your own behaviors, your own classroom. What are you doing to create that safe and positive culture or community? And we really have to remember, never give up. Sometimes this is a very hard work, and we have to repeat and do over and keep going. That's okay. We don't ever want to give up on our kids and on making that classroom inclusive and accepting and positive. All right, as a few more of you send in your comments, I'm going to keep going because I want to address the issue that was brought out on page 126 and 127 in your text about self-esteem and self-efficacy. What are those two issues? When we look at self-esteem, it's being capable of meeting life's challenges. It's a sense of competence and worthiness. It's a sense of self-efficacy. Okay, so that's self-esteem. So what is self-efficacy? It's that I can reach my goals. I can complete my tasks. It's that belief in self. And so often in the past, particularly, we've really thought about self-esteem as getting kids to feel good about themselves. And it's not that may be part of it, but it's really about their sense that they can meet life's challenges. They can do it. I've practiced, I've worked hard, I can do this. I'm worthy of the effort. So that's where we're really building self-esteem. It is not a predictor of better health practices. Okay, does that catch you off guard? Self-esteem is not a predictor of better health practices or greater social responsibility or less participation in antisocial behavior. I want you to think about the classroom bully. They have great self-esteem. They feel that they can meet life's challenges. They are competent in their skills, no matter how negative. And they think that That is how they will attain their goals to complete their tasks. They have great self-esteem. That they are not engaging in healthy practices or having great social responsibility. So we need to separate out self-esteem from health practices. And that assumption that many of us come with. If I can build the self-esteem of my students, they'll be healthier. We want to build the self-esteem of students by giving them the tools to meet all those daily life challenges, to feel like they can engage in those health skills that are addressed in the content standards. And so really what it comes down to is, as a teacher, how do we speak to children? Let's encourage children to do well rather than feel good about themselves. Yeah. Sometimes we talk about, we want to make our kids feel good, and we're giving them praise for something that they did not do well. And they know that they didn't do it well. So we really want to encourage that doing well. We want to ask real questions and listen to their responses. Really hear what they are having to say. And avoid those trite statements of, good job, you got it, even if they didn't. So we really want to watch our own language. There are some other things that we can do to promote self-esteem and self-efficacy in our classrooms. The first is to provide security. Enable your children to feel safe in the classroom. That's those rules. That's that routine. We want to create that safe environment. Remember back to coordinated school health programs, that second day? We talked about that healthy school environment. In the whole school, whole child, whole community model, they actually broke that into two. Physically a safe environment, but also the school climate, that emotional safety. So we want to look at climate and culture as well as the buildings of our school. So we want to provide security. Secondly, we want to enable identity. We want to enable children to see their uniqueness, see their strengths and their weaknesses. And those are all of those "Who am I?" activities that we so often do in schools. Each child is unique. They all have their strengths and weaknesses, just as we as adults are and do. We want to help them enable or find that identity. We also want to support belonging. Enable children to feel accepted as part of that bigger group. So learning about each other, doing group work, dealing with conflict, even learning some of those social graces like please and thank you, really supports that belonging. So while each child is a unique individual in your class, they are part of that classroom community, or as one of you said, the classroom family. We also want to enable purpose. Enable children to have goals. Allow them to set daily or weekly goals. Help them identify others that they admire and kind of use them as a role model. When we have purpose, we build our feelings of self-esteem. And then lastly, develop competence. Enable children to believe that they can reach their goals, that they can be successful, that they are making progress, and that they can praise themselves for that progress. We don't always need to be the ones praising or giving stickers or check marks on a contract. We want them to start taking that on internally. All right, so those are just a few ways that we can enable that self-efficacy, build that self-esteem in our classrooms. Okay, let me take a quick break and hear from a couple more of you about what you are doing to build mental, emotional health in the children in which you work. Danielle, glad you are here. Danielle starts out by saying, I haven't given much thought to the mental and emotional well-being of my students beyond what I would do for any child. And that is to make sure that they know that they are cared for and supported and their feelings and thoughts matter. Recently, I had an issue dealing with a student who I believe has an undiagnosed mental illness. I've been focused on creating a positive atmosphere in my classroom. We talk about the fact that everyone makes mistakes and we learn from those mistakes and that he is a valued member of our classroom. It has made me realize that I need to put more focus on the emotional and mental health of my students. All right, good that you've realized that and good that you're already doing so much. All right, good morning, Kylie, glad you are here. One of the biggest things I can do as a classroom teacher is push for a system of positive behavioral intervention, which focuses on positively impacting student behavior rather than finding faults and getting them in trouble. I like that approach. I think so often it's easy to identify those who are not doing what they're supposed to and call them out, but let's focus on those who are engaged in positive behaviors. This is an immediate school-wide program implementation that supports students and gives them something positive to look forward to each day. And I really see it making a difference in my students' emotional health and willingness to participate in the classroom. You can't always reach every kid, but giving them that one positive moment each day can build and make a difference. Strongly agree with that. All right, thank you so much for that. And I think that's all I've got on comments. So let's keep going on. Thank you all for sharing your take on this. And I do want to recognize that many of you are doing many things to build the mental and emotional health of children. And I do hope that as you read, you might pick up some new ideas, some new ways to strengthen what you're already doing. All right, so we've talked about self-esteem and self-efficacy. Another term that you're going to hear a lot in education is about resilience. So how do we foster resilience? Let's see a quick video clip. Because we really want to find out first, what is resilience?
Why do some people do well despite serious hardships? The science of resilience can help us find answers.
We define resilience as a good outcome in the face of adversity.
The extent to which we can build capacities in all children early in their lives to be able to deal with whatever bumps in the road or major obstacles may be coming down the track. That's an investment in building strong human capital and healthy, productive adults.
Some children face more obstacles and adversity than others.
It's like having a parent with a major mental illness, growing up in a very socioeconomically disadvantaged community, going to schools that are not good, being exposed to violence in the neighborhood or in the home.
But some children do well despite these significant obstacles.
Resilience is that ability or set of capacities for positive adaptation, allowing you to keep in balance.
We're talking about the kinds of capacities and skills and the abilities that give people a sense of mastery and management of difficulty.
It's tempting to think about children as either having this resilient quality or not, but resilience is built over time, just as in parallel with how the architecture of the brain is built over time.
It's not just in the person. It's in the interaction between the person and the environment.
So we care about resilience for the same reason that we care about promoting healthy development, because in many respects it is the same. We are interested in promoting resilience in children so that, despite the odds, more and more children can grow up to be productive citizens.
Okay, so fostering resilience is another perspective of what we do in our classrooms. Remember that resilience is the ability to bounce back successfully despite exposure to severe risks. And so obviously the video clip identified some of those risks. And I do like that one statement. It's really very linked into promoting healthy growth and development. It's part of that. It's not just the physical stuff, but it is that growth and development of that individual. Certainly, we can foster resilience with some of the same strategies that we've identified as supporting the mental, emotional, social health of children. Creating one-to-one time with students. Sometimes we can even share some of our own experiences with appropriate self-disclosure, because that kind of builds that bond with kids. I found this really tough to do when I first started learning this. You know, what do you think? Is it a little tough for you? And sharing, you know, even what you've done to get over a hump. You know, when I'm really, really sad, you know, this is what I do. So appropriate self-disclosure. The other thing when we are fostering resilience is we want to have high expectations and believe in our students' capabilities. Don't cut them short. Don't sell them short. Certainly, we also want to network with family and friends. When at-risk children become resilient adults, they often have named teachers as an important part of their growth. So just kind of keep that in mind as we continue, okay? All right, so what do, you know what? Let me stop here. I think I've got several more comments, so let's go ahead and take this rather than my going on to the next one. So again, in response to the question of the day, how do you support the mental, emotional health of children? Scott says, supporting begins each day when I greet my students individually and check in with them to see how they're doing. For some of my students, their current well-being is apparent through their language and behavior. But for some of my nonverbal, it is more of a challenge to find out how they are doing each day. Given the maladaptive behaviors of many of my students, it's not always easy to maintain a physically safe space for my students, but I have made this one of my most important goals this year. This means monitoring my students throughout the day and providing them with strategies for self-regulation. All right, thank you so much, Mark, for being with us this morning and for sharing that. I think there is significant power in greeting every individual student as they come in to see you in the morning and checking in with them individually throughout the day. I think that's really powerful. All right, good morning, Martha. Glad you are here. Now remember, Martha is working with 3 to 5 year old students with lots of different exceptionalities. So here's a list of a few things she's doing. Encouraging a collaborative, cooperative environment where students respond to the emotions of teachers and peers. Right, collaborative and cooperative, and just understanding emotions, good part. Number 2, having an area for students to calm down where they can do animal yoga. So you've already taught them the animal yoga. It's just a place to go and regroup. And don't we as adults find that we do that? We may not do the animal yoga, but sometimes we just need to take a step back and calm down. Number 3, having sensory baskets in each area of my classroom to meet the sensory needs of students. Number 4, offering choices It delays those impulsive behaviors and keeps my students engaged. Number 5, praise appropriate behaviors or approximations of appropriate behaviors. Oh, I like that you pulled that out. Even if they haven't quite got it, they're working toward it. Thank you. And then number 6, encouraging and teaching communication and language. Remembering that all behavior is a form of communication. All right, so we really want, sounds to me like, Martha, you are doing a lot with those littles. 3 to 5 year olds, they're learning so much, and yours with all of the exceptionalities you listed certainly have an environment where they can grow, I think. Okay, so let's just take a quick look at recognizing and helping our students. So I think those are two key words that we always want to kind of have in mind. First, we need to recognize when our students are having problems, and then we need to know what to do to help. Okay. So first off, we want to understand and recognize the signs and symptoms of mental and emotional health conditions. So we do have to go back and review some of those commonly seen issues in children. We want to remember that teachers are not counselors or mental health professionals. Sometimes we want to do it all, and we really want to help that child, but remember, we are not trained counselors or mental health professionals. So we do not diagnose, interview children, or express opinions about diagnoses to parents or caregivers. So, and that's sometimes hard to do because we do have a great deal of background information, but we need to be really careful and maybe asking more questions from parents or caregivers. What do you see at home? You know, how are things going? Have they been seen at the healthcare provider's office, etc.? Do not give them a diagnosis. We do not armchair diagnosis teachers. But you do need to know where to go for more information. Know who to speak to on campus. So you're going to look at some websites. You might want to remember a few of those. You may want to look at some of the references that the textbook uses. You do need to know where to go for more information. And you need to know who on your campus is available to you that may have greater expertise. And just remember that sometimes, while it's not the diagnosis, it's just those simple interactions we have with students that can be very powerful in helping them. Let's watch a video clip called "School is a Powerful Support System."
I had teachers that I felt like responded so well. I don't know if they knew what to do or how they knew, but they just were great. And I remember one of my teachers just said, that day we were supposed to be doing a court case in this history class. And I remember I was supposed to be the judge, and I was kind of excited to be the judge in this, you know, court case hearing we were having in school in that period. And she just pulled me aside and just said, if you need to leave, you can leave. If you need to stay and you just want to sit, you can just stay and sit. If you want to go in the auditorium where, you know, the kids are and the counselors are, you can go there. Whatever you need, you just let me know. You just do whatever you need to do. It was perfect. I didn't know what I needed, and she was giving me permission to do whatever that was, because it was perfect what she said. And I didn't show it to her at the time, but because I didn't want to show any emotion, because I knew I'd just break down and start crying in class, and I didn't want to do that. But it meant so much to me what she did, that she just knew to say that, and I just had huge respect and love for her after that because of her insight. And I never showed it at the time, but inside I was like, oh, thank you, that was perfect. You know, that's what I needed. All the support that I felt at school was like, that was the best place for me to be. You know, people might think, oh, stay home. For me, it wasn't. For me, it was the best place for me to be was school, because that was my comfort zone. That is where my friends are. That's where I am every day. Why would I want to not be where my friends are? And that made the most sense. And I think as a teenager, I think I remember my mom and some other adults just saying, like, is she talking to anyone? Like, is she okay? And I just thought, I just want to talk to my friends. I just want to be where they are. And so that was the best support that I could have had.
Okay, friends and teachers can be a very powerful support to any of our students who are struggling with some of these mental and emotional issues. Let's just do a little quick check for understanding again. We've covered again a big chunk of content. I want you to remember back and respond to these. A child who is described as resilient shows the ability to do what during hard times? Bounce back. Bounce back. All right, teachers who encourage students to do well rather than feel good are contributing to what? Self-esteem and self-efficacy, remember? And then last, when at-risk children become resilient adults, whom do they most often name as being important in their growth? The teacher. Okay, so some little quick questions to get you to think back to the chunk of information that we just addressed. Well, just right before we go to break, I just want one more point here for you about working with children and supporting their mental and emotional health. I want to encourage you to also take care of yourself. Just as health promotion for staff is part of coordinated school health, taking care of yourself is important as you take care of your students. Teachers who are too exhausted mentally, emotionally, or physically are unlikely to help anyone, including their students. Okay, so eat well, be active, get plenty of sleep, manage your stress in healthy ways, and certainly that will help you along your way to take care of yourself as you work with students. All right, so here's a 10-minute break so you can take care of yourself. Eat well, be active, manage your stress in the next 10 minutes. And if you haven't had a chance to respond to the question of the day, you can certainly take this opportunity to get your email in or wait on the line for after break, and we will go ahead and take that verbally. So I'll see you in 10 minutes when we come back and talk about some of the common mental health disorders you may see in schools. All right, see you in 10.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The Certificate Program in Social Media Strategies and Content Marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction, identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community, create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience, distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals, become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
One of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what HUCS 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is the advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities? I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, both of our anecdotes are about, you know, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
Technology enables, you know, involvement through Skype and FaceTime and the idea of a symposium and having a physical presence on campus at the end of the program really ties things up very well, yet shouldn't scare anyone away because there's all sorts of potential for involvement through the technology. Being part of a cohort doesn't mean you're just sitting in front of your computer in your bedroom. You're actually part of a group, and that, I think that's what the experience will be, is the cohort experience.
Benefits of this model involves the faculty because we can be closer to one another and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The thematic approach and building through a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future HUCS students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the five terms of this program.
Hi, my name is Mara Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, welcome back. This is the second hour of our two-hour broadcast. Hope you were able to do a little bit of self-care over your break and are ready to continue with our discussion on mental and emotional health problems, how they affect children's health and academic achievement. I do have up the question of the day. I want to thank all of you who have already responded, and I want to encourage you to continue to think about that question throughout this week, and maybe try some of the things that we've talked about or that you've read or seen on some of the resources. I do have one more comment before we get started. This is from Renee. Renee says that in early childhood education, we orchestrate students' IEPs. So I try to write good, thorough evaluations for social behavior and academic score goals that promote healthy development over time. And that's something we won't really think about. The IEP is really powerful. And really think about what you are doing as the basis for that and your observations and evaluations, but how you are setting goals for students and working with them and their families and the support providers around the table. So thanks for reminding us of that, Renee. Okay, so we've talked a lot about what we can do in a classroom. Let's just do a quick review of some of the mental, emotional problems that you may see in a classroom that may impact your students' academic standing, their health, their behavior, etc. And first, let's talk about anxiety disorders. This is a broad category which includes generalized anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorders, panic, post-traumatic stress disorder, and social phobias. Let's take a look at a quick video, anxiety disorders in children.
The term we see many times, anxiety disorder, what does that mean?
Increasingly, children are coming in with higher and higher rates of anxiety disorders. Now, anxiety tends to run in families. It tends to be genetic, but still, it's the stress and the pressure that seems to be bringing it out now in earlier ages. When I first started my practice, I really didn't get many kids complaining of anxiety. It seems to be it's becoming so common. I have kids who, out of anxiety, some of the symptoms of anxiety, obviously, nervousness, worrying, anticipating dreadful events. Their mother leaves, driving somewhere, they're afraid she's going to have a car accident. They have to call her on the cell phone 5 times to make sure she's okay. We all know about the little kindergartner who goes into his first day of kindergarten, he's clutching his mom's hand, and all the other children are separating from their parents. He's clinging and has to be coached and cajoled into the school building.
And is this a kind of disorder that's treatable with talking or needs medication?
If it's really heavily family genetic, they're often, not necessarily in childhood years, but very often eventually medication does have to get used, especially if you get a school, what we call it school refusal or school phobia. And there you get a situation where a kid is terrified of going into school and they're not making it up. It's not a kid who's being defiant and oppositional. Those kids often will need some medication, but they tend to give them very light medications to help with their nerves. But no, most of these things can be treated without medication.
Okay, I really want to reiterate that last statement. Most of the anxiety disorders can be treated with supportive measures rather than medication. And I do think, you know, we live in a culture where we want a drug to fix everything. And so oftentimes we think about that with mental health disorders, is what drug can we get these kids on? Supportive interventions, interpersonal interventions can go a long way. So just want to remind you of that. There at the beginning of that video, you saw the very first visual was the word stress. And anxiety disorders often result from extreme levels of stress. And I want to remind us all that stress is that non-specific response of the body to an unanticipated or stimulating kind of event. So it's just a natural reaction. Eustress is pleasant. Getting married can be a very pleasant yet stressful event. It can be distress, which is very unpleasant, the death or the loss of a loved one. So stress is just part of life. It's really how we view it and how we deal with it. And whether it is acute, meaning periodic, short-term, or chronic. If we are living in a state of chronic stress, certainly going to have a much greater impact on our mental and emotional health as well as our physical health. Here's a few tips just to consider in your own classroom for your stress level and for the stress level of your students. Exercise and activity is a great outlet for all of that. Get up and move some. On the opposite end, learn to relax, whether that's deep breathing, progressive muscle relaxation, creative visualization, lots of different ways that we can learn to relax. So sometimes we need to get that out, sometimes we just need to calm. Laughing is great medicine, as is some quiet, calming music. Time management certainly is one of those skills that we learn that help us cope with some of the things that cause us stress. And then, of course, improving communication. So as we can help our students deal with their stress in any of those ways. We're giving them skills for a lifetime, because as you know, stress never goes away. Okay, let's talk about another common mental emotional health issue that we see frequently in schools, and that is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Remember that there are really three components to ADHD: impulsiveness, hyperactivity, and inattention. Impulsiveness, hyperactivity, and inattention. Depending on what form an individual may have, they may exhibit one of those symptoms or a combination of them. Let's take a quick look at this video clip. What are the signs and symptoms of childhood ADHD?
Adrian, how are you?
How you doing? Give me five.
School is becoming a struggle for first grader Adrian, who is easily distracted.
He's really active. He doesn't stay still.
You get lots of homework, Adrian?
Yes.
Yeah? How many pages?
15.
He's unable to complete the homework.
Yes, and he doesn't stay still. He just gets distracted easily.
Pediatrician Blanca Fresno of Children's Physicians Medical Group says children who have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, are more likely to have learning difficulties, but can succeed in school with the right support and treatment.
ADHD is a condition that affects the child in such a way that he or she is not able to control their behavior. It affects them in their everyday life, it affects them in their school performance, and in their relationships.
The three main symptoms of ADHD are inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity.
When the symptoms start affecting all the areas and things become out of control, pretty much you need to seek an evaluation. We're gonna check his vision and his hearing, and I'm gonna give you some questionnaires for you to fill out, and the teacher needs to fill those out as well. We test them for their vision and their hearing, and then we provide the family with a questionnaire. These are standardized questionnaires, and they are supposed to be answered by the parents and by the teachers. And when they come back and follow up, we score these questionnaires, and those scores give us the risk for the patient.
A detailed family history is important because often there is a close relative with the disorder.
ADHD is seen in the family. Often we find out that it's in the father or a cousin or an uncle, sometimes in the mother.
If we decide that Adrian does have ADHD, what would be the process?
There are three different ways to approach treatment: through the school, through counseling, and through medical treatment.
The use of prescribed stimulant medications in the treatment of ADHD continues to be strongly debated. However, many pediatricians say in most cases these medications work well in controlling symptoms of hyperactivity, impulsivity, and help improve focus.
These medications have been out in use for so long, we do know that the outcome in children who use medications is better than those children that don't use medication.
Dr. Fresno likes to show parents this before and after example of how medication improved a young child's focus in his schoolwork.
You can see how focused the work is here and how chaotic is there.
Academic support can range from tutoring, preferential seating, extended time on tests, and even using electronic teaching methods such as tablets. Dr. Fresno says it's important for both parents and children to learn ways to cope with ADHD.
Empowering these children with knowledge, giving them enough counseling to find out that there's absolutely nothing wrong with them. That's simply how they are and how they live in the world. And giving them the right guidance to succeed prevents so much of the complications of low self-esteem.
For more information on ADHD and other children's health topics, call 877-276-4543. or visit cpmgsandiego.com.
All right, so certainly a shift in maybe how we think about ADHD, rather than there's something wrong with the child, it's how they process their world. So what can we do to provide them academic support, counseling, and then, if appropriate, what medications may help them? So certainly I'm confident that you've all come across students who have difficulty with that impulsivity, hyperactivity, and inattention. Again, remember, we are not mental health professionals, so we are certainly not in the position to diagnose or to recommend treatments, but again, to refer to mental health providers and continue that supportive work that we do in classrooms. All right, so let's look now at bipolar disorders. When we think about bipolar disorder, I want you to think about the episodes of mania and depression, the highs and the lows. The next video clip gives us a little bit of insight into children with bipolar disorders. It's entitled Raising Sadie, My Bipolar Child.
I started to notice in preschool that her behavior was different than the other kids her age. Sometimes she'd be really happy one minute and all of a sudden I'd look in the rearview mirror and see her face look really upset, and she'd start freaking out about something that had happened a long time ago and worrying that that was going to make her die. Her preschool wanted me to have her evaluated, and at that time I had never even heard of a three-year-old undergoing a psychological evaluation. I felt really bad about myself as a mom. I thought, I am just not doing things right. I was resistant to label her with anything, and I gradually came to realize by kindergarten, well, she is being labeled anyway. She's being labeled as the bad kid, the naughty kid, the girl that doesn't listen.
Kids with bipolar disorder have some awareness that something's wrong, something's not right. They're doing things that are different from their peers, they're having a harder time functioning, getting angry, getting irritable, feeling inexplicably really sad.
A really low point was when I was reading her a book at night and she just all of a sudden started sobbing and said, you know, I just feel like I don't belong on this planet anymore. By then I really knew that something was seriously going on. You'll do anything when you're that desperate to help your child to stop suffering.
For many families, it's a tremendous relief to receive the diagnosis of bipolar disorder. It's an acknowledgement that, no, the parents aren't crazy, no, it isn't a bad child, that in fact, they have a biochemical disorder, and it can be named and it can be treated.
When the psychiatrist gave her a test to rank her own depression, it was like off the charts. And she had, I remember when I handed it to her, on the one hand, it was kind of a good feeling because she identified with the questions that were being asked, and it was a way for her to articulate it where she hadn't really been able to before. It was just, I'm bad and I'm stupid. And now she saw all these questions yes, this is how I feel all the time.
I don't think it's clear with any child where they're going to end up as an adult. Sadie is likely to have ups and downs throughout her life. How extreme, it's hard to say.
The medication definitely helped her. She's a pretty normal little 11-year-old girl. I think about what it would be like if she wasn't medicated, and I still sometimes have hopes that we can take her off it, but without it, I just felt like she was losing her childhood.
I love you.
I love you too.
Okay, I think that's a really good video clip for all of us to watch. One, because it gives us some information about bipolar disorder, which we tend not to think about with children, but yet so many are impacted by it. But the thing I really like is to see and hear the mom, to maybe give us an understanding of the struggles that family go through with all of these issues. So very often I come across teachers who are terribly frustrated, even angry with a child because of their behaviors related to a mental emotional health problem. And I think it's always good to bring us back to the frustrations that are experienced by family and the hope that family members have that their child will be able to be part of a classroom community and to have a successful school career, have a successful life. So, you know, if you need to watch that video again, just again to watch and hear mom, I think that's pretty powerful. Just as bipolar is probably something we don't think about very often, depression is one of those mental emotional disorders that we probably do think about quite frequently. There is much more media focus on depression, and I think we recognize it that, you know, it can be short-lived, it can be a very chronic condition. And maybe because we may know individuals who are experiencing depression, it's a little bit easier for us to think about and to talk about. I have another video clip for you on depression, so watch and listen.
Depression is the leading cause of disability in the world. In the United States, close to 10% of adults struggle with depression. But because it's a mental illness, it can be a lot harder to understand than, say, high cholesterol. One major source of confusion is the difference between having depression and just feeling depressed. Almost everyone feels down from time to time. Getting a bad grade, losing a job, having an argument, even a rainy day can bring on feelings of sadness. Sometimes there's no trigger at all. It just pops up out of the blue. Then circumstances change, and those sad feelings disappear. Clinical depression is different. It's a medical disorder, and it won't go away just because you want it to. It lingers for at least 2 consecutive weeks and significantly interferes with one's ability to work, play, or love. Depression can have a lot of different symptoms: a low mood, loss of interest in things you'd normally enjoy, changes in appetite, feeling worthless or excessively guilty, sleeping either too much or too little, poor concentration, restlessness or slowness, loss of energy, or recurrent thoughts of suicide. If you have at least 5 of those symptoms, according to psychiatric guidelines, you qualify for a diagnosis of depression. And it's not just behavioral symptoms. Depression has physical manifestations inside the brain. First of all, there are changes that could be seen with the naked eye and X-ray vision. These include smaller frontal lobes and hippocampal volumes. On a more micro scale, depression is associated with a few things: the abnormal transmission or depletion of certain neurotransmitters, especially serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine, blunted circadian rhythms, or specific changes in the REM and slow wave parts of your sleep cycle, and hormone abnormalities, such as high cortisol and deregulation of thyroid hormones. But neuroscientists still don't have a complete picture of what causes depression. It seems to have to do with a complex interaction between genes and environment, but we don't have a diagnostic tool that can accurately predict where or when it will show up. And because depression symptoms are intangible, it's hard to know who might look fine but is actually struggling. According to the National Institute of Mental Health, it takes the average person suffering with a mental illness over 10 years to ask for help. But there are very effective treatments. Medications and therapy complement each other to boost brain chemicals. In extreme cases, electroconvulsive therapy, which is like a controlled seizure in the patient's brain, is also very helpful. Other promising treatments, like transcranial magnetic stimulation, are being investigated too. So if you know someone struggling with depression, encourage them, gently, to seek out some of these options. You might even offer to help with specific tasks, like looking up therapists in the area, or making a list of questions to ask a doctor. To someone with depression, these first steps can seem insurmountable. If they feel guilty or ashamed, point out that depression is a medical condition, just like asthma or diabetes. It's not a weakness or a personality trait, and they shouldn't expect themselves to just get over it, any more than they could will themselves to get over a broken arm. If you haven't experienced depression yourself, avoid comparing it to times you've felt down. Comparing what they're experiencing to normal, temporary feelings of sadness can make them feel guilty for struggling. Even just talking about depression openly can help. For example, research shows that asking someone about suicidal thoughts actually reduces their suicide risk. Open conversations about mental illness help erode stigma and make it easier for people to ask for help. And the more patients seek treatment, the more scientists will learn about depression, and the better the treatments will get.
Okay, so a difference between feeling depressed and clinical depression. And oftentimes in those interviews, it's really looking at your feelings and your behaviors over a two-week period where those intense feelings of sadness interfere with daily living. And I'm struck in the video by the fact it says that for many, it takes 10 years to get to that diagnosis. And hopefully we as teachers, as we learn more and as we work with our students, as we connect with mental health professionals to get students support, hopefully we can diminish that 10-year time frame down to a much more manageable time frame where individuals can not only feel better about themselves, their lives, their abilities, but they can diminish some of the struggles that they deal with, all of that. So I do hope as we're going through each of these, you know, you're thinking about, you know, some of the signs, the symptoms, what might you notice in a classroom, and then your next steps. What do you do in, you know, talking to a parent? How are you asking them without putting them on the defensive or accusing them of not noticing? You know, just some simple open-ended questions on how are things going? I'm noticing this in class. Do you ever notice these kinds of behaviors at home? Is there anything that I need to know about your child or your family that would help me work with them? And then really remembering that referral process. Talk to those at your school site who have that expertise, who know the resources in your community, and can work with a family to access those. So I just want to put that plug in there and know that should be your immediate response as you think about any of these. The next mental health disorder I just want to do a quick review of for you are the eating disorders. Oftentimes people say, well, why are we talking about this here? Isn't that something we address in nutrition? Eating disorders are mental health disorders. They are not nutrition disorders. Yes, there is a nutritional component to it, but the issue is mental health. And when we talk about eating disorders, we're talking about anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, binge eating disorders. There is a spectrum of behaviors here. Let's take a look at one more video that will address these most common eating disorders.
As far as the most common eating disorders, I guess I'll first mention that really there are three official eating disorder diagnoses that are sort of officially recognized within the mental health community. So that means that there are three eating disorder diagnoses that are currently listed in the Diagnostic Manual of Psychiatry and Mental Health called the DSM-4. And those three eating disorder diagnoses are anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, and there's a third diagnosis called eating disorder not otherwise specified. Professionals sometimes call it EDNOS, it's sort of the acronym for short. And so I'll sort of speak about these three categories primarily. So anorexia nervosa and bulimia nervosa, we know, tend to affect women with, you know, much higher proportions than men. It's probably something like a 9-to-1 ratio of women to men affected by these problems. And in anorexia nervosa, we know that lifetime prevalence of this type of problem in women is about 1% of the population. Bulimia nervosa, the rates are slightly higher still, 2% of lifetime prevalence in women. Then we have this third category, eating disorder not otherwise specified, which is a very sort of heterogeneous category, I guess you would say. It has lots of different types of eating problems in it. And it might not be surprising to hear that that's actually the largest category. More people in the eating disorder not otherwise specified category than in anorexia or bulimia nervosa, and probably both of those combined. So eating disorders not otherwise specified encompasses a lot of other types of eating problems. One that is very prevalent is binge eating disorder. So that probably encompasses actually of people that present to obesity and weight loss clinics, maybe up to 30% of those people presenting to those clinics may have some type of binge eating disorder problem. So binge eating disorder is a repetitive pattern of repeated engagement in episodes of binge eating. And a binge, we sort of officially define as engaging within a fixed period of time, maybe a 2-hour period, engaging in eating a large quantity of food, much larger than what most people would consider appropriate for a normal meal, with an associated sense of loss of control around that eating event. So many of us have sat down and eaten a good bit more than we thought was appropriate for a normal meal, maybe at Thanksgiving dinner, by the way, you know, for example. But when there's sort of that sense of loss of control around it, and when it's happening on a repetitive basis, that is sort of the essence of binge eating disorder. And there are other problems that are encompassed within that eating disorder not otherwise specified category right now. Problems like night eating syndrome, problems like purging disorder, where there's purging behavior like vomiting in the absence of binge eating behavior, and other types of problems that kind of look like anorexia nervosa and bulimia nervosa, but maybe aren't quite as severe or a little bit different in the way they present, and so don't meet those sort of strict criteria for those two groups. Whatever the eating problem, the most important thing is to try to acknowledge that a problem is going on and to reach out to a treatment center or a mental health professional in order to try to get help from the problem.
Okay, so we've gone through a lot of information today. One of the mental health issues that really is not addressed in Chapter 5 is that of self-harm, specifically suicide. I do want to just reference a couple of items on Blackboard and share with you one of those. Suicide is often the action that occurs as people are coping ineffectively with mental health disorders, and in particular with depression. So what I've done is in this module for you on Blackboard, I have put in several resources for you, and I put them in here because oftentimes we think of suicide when we think of mental health. There is a toolkit for schools, and I certainly encourage you to check at your own school site and find out what is in your safety plan or your crisis plan for dealing with students who express suicidal ideations or those who have committed suicide? What is it that your school is ready to do? I have provided you a link to the Los Angeles Unified School District's mental health services for those of you who are within the LAUSD parameters. And then I want to show you the Los Angeles County Suicide Prevention Project, because I think most of us are in Los Angeles County. This is a great resource, an overview of suicide, including some video clips that you can watch. Just some facts about suicide. Males commit suicide, are more likely to die by suicide than their female peers, yet females are more likely to attempt suicide than males. The guns remain the most commonly used suicide method among youth. However, there has been some decrease in that, with an increase in suffocation, especially young girls. But here are some things under Did You Know that I encourage you to take a look at. Depression is the most prevalent mental health disorder. 1 in 33 children, 1 in 8 adolescents. And it goes on to talk about depression is a psychiatric diagnosis most commonly associated with suicide, and approximately 2/3 of people who die by suicide are depressed at the time of their death. So certainly depression and suicide are linked. There are great resources here for administrators and staff, for parents and students, and then, of course, some resources that you can access both for Los Angeles County as well as throughout California and then on a national level. So I really encourage you to take a look at this site. This is one that is posted on Blackboard for you. So certainly, again, this is one that we're going to talk about more as we go into chapters 10 on injury prevention, violence. It is violence against self. And then as we look at chapter 14, which is about growth, development, and the aging and dying process. So we will touch on this again, but I think it's really important for you to also have this as a resource here for you in chapter 5 when we're talking about mental and emotional health issues. Please do remember, as we are talking about all of this, those models that we addressed early on, coordinated school health model or the whole school, whole child, whole community models. I want to keep bringing those back up again and again, remembering that there are resources in your school, in your communities, that you can access as you deal with these issues. There are, you know, the psychological counseling services, the community services. Remember family connections and family involvement. And also for yourself, a health promotion for staff. Because certainly we too can be affected by any of these across the spectrum. Certainly there are some great websites for you to go to. So if we could go back to my desktop, I just want to highlight a few of these for you as we kind of end up today. The first website that I have on my desktop is mentalhealth.gov. There we go. This is the website that comes out of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. This is kind of the national resource here. But certainly features on suicide prevention, coping with trauma, there are specific resources available in Spanish and for veterans. As you go down this very front page, just some basic information about mental health, what to look for. Again, some of those signs and symptoms that may be addressed in your textbook and we've gone through very quickly. The importance of talking about mental health. When you look at the content standards for California public schools, you will see there is a content area, mental, emotional, and social health, where we are building some foundation through the lessons that we provide with students. I encourage you to take a look at that, and then take a look at talking about mental health just as an intervention strategy. And then, of course, how to get help. You can find information on just about any mental health disorder that you want some more information on at this website. So that's mentalhealth.gov. Another very good resource to look at is the National Institute of Mental Health. Let's see if I can make this a little bit bigger. We lose part of the page. But this is the National Institute of Mental Health, which comes out of the National Institute of Health. So this is a subcategory. The web address here, www.nimh.nih.gov. Again, health topics, all of the variety of issues that we've talked about already, and many more. So that is the National Institute of Mental Health. The National Alliance of Mental Illness is really about supporting individuals and families who are coping with mental illness. And there are local chapters that individuals can connect with. And again, lots of information here as well. The National Alliance on Mental Health is nami.org. And the American Psychological Association is a great resource for all of us to use. It is geared to psychologists, and it is a membership organization, but their website has a lot of good information. Everything from education to the science behind some of all of this. And then, of course, you can search anything through their topic list. For those of you who would like more information on eating disorders, you might want to check out the nationaleatingdisorders.org website. Again, a great deal of information about eating disorders and how to talk about eating disorders with family, friends, those who may be affected by that. And some great stories of hope here as well. And I think that's the thing to remember as we look at all of these, is we have to remember these stories of hope. Helpguide.org. I encourage all of you to flag this one. Helpguide.org. Resources, 31 different topics. On mental, emotional, and social health. They link to some of the websites you've already heard about. There's Harvard Health. But again, there are lots of places to go for more information. And remember back, I said that as we learn to recognize and help our students, we need to know where to go for that information. So I'm just sharing a few of those with you. And then my last three for today really are focused on you as the teacher. And these are websites that will certainly talk about some of the health issues that we address in this class. As they are geared to teachers, they will have a great deal more. So I hope you will check these out. The first is edutopia.org, and this comes out of the George Lucas Educational Foundation. Been around 25 years, and they include a great deal on classroom management and brain-based learning. So again, gives us some resources for how to strengthen our students' focus and their ability to calm when they need to calm and energize when they need to energize. Scroll through here, read some. You will find things from the parents' perspective, from the students' perspective, and then, of course, you are linked into lots of resources that you might be able to use in your own classroom. TeachThought.com, a great website for teachers and parents. Lots of resources, professional development. You can link into podcasts if that's something you want to look at. And many of them very much focused on helping students learn and creating highly effective learning environments. I do like Teach Thought. And most of these also, if you want to follow them on Facebook or Twitter, they also are available there. And then my last website of the morning is the Teaching Channel. These are some video-based samples of students and teachers at work in classrooms. Everything from Common Core, language arts, and math to just teaching strategies. So I hope you'll take a look at some of those as well. Okay, so that's it for the desktop. Thank you for letting me just share some of those very quickly with you. I think as we draw near our end time today, I certainly want to encourage you to again gain as much information as you can about mental and emotional health problems, with the intent that you also identify some of your resources in your school and in your community, that you realize that you are working in partnership with students and their families. You really want to build a safe and caring classroom community. You want to foster resilience in each and every one of your students. You want to be able to recognize and refer those students who may have problems. And don't forget, you need to take care of yourself as well. So that's a lot to address. We could probably spend many broadcasts on just this one content area, but our limitations of a semester prohibit us from doing that. I'm going to encourage you to go back and read and reread. Don't just take it and move on to the next. And know that this content area will be connected with others as we go along in the semester. I do want to remind each of you that there is a journal entry due by Monday evening. That is all that is due Monday. So you have a little bit of a break. Remember that you probably want to get started on your website reviews. If not actually writing them, at least reviewing, thinking about, maybe even getting to the draft part. Email me if you are interested in signing up for the CPR class on November 5, because we had to reschedule. And then, of course, preparing for our next 2 weeks. Next week, we're going to start nutrition. We will actually spend 2 weeks on nutrition and physical activity. If you are limited in your time this week, focus on chapter 6. If you have a little bit of extra time, I'd go chapter 6 and chapter 7. So we'll be addressing those two over the next 2 weeks. So that kind of lays out some of the things you need to do. And as we close, again, I want to wish each of you health, peace, and happiness. See you next week.